as we're listening to that song. About the worship in the throne room, the realization that we're there. But to step into that reality, we have to abide there by faith. So I'm going to open with Psalm 91. We really don't know who the author of that psalm is. It could have been Moses or David. Of course, Psalm 90 was a psalm of Moses. Psalm 92 was a psalm of David. Of course, it's right between. Certainly, Moses had these revelations as well as David. So, he that dwelleth in the secret place or the hidden place in Christ, shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver me from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover me with His feathers. There's the throne room, the seraphim. The seraphim's wings, and under His wings thou shalt trust. His truth shall be thy shield and thy buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall by thy side, and 10,000 by thy right hand. But it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord thy refuge, the Most High thine habitation. No evil shall befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. He shall give His angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in the hands, in the Father's hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon, shalt thou trample under feet in this place. We trample upon the enemy, far above all principality and power, dominion and might. The young lion and the dragon shall thou trample under feet. Because you have set your love upon Him, therefore will He deliver you. You will set Him on high because we have known His name. When we call upon Him, He will answer us. He will deliver us and honor us. With long life will He satisfy us and show us His salvation. Holy Spirit, we thank You for continuing to teach us and shining the light of Christ upon us, that we may come into the fullness of our identity by faith, that we may lay hold of our inheritance in You, in the throne room. That the glorious high throne from the beginning is the place of our sanctuary. That we are inheriting the throne of glory. Thank You for giving us a spirit of wisdom and unveiling and the awareness, the consciousness of You the eyes of our hearts being enlightened, that we may know what is the hope of your calling of that Christ in us, and what the riches of the glory of your inheritance in the saints, and what the exceeding greatness of your power to us who believe, according to the working of your mighty power which you wrought in Christ, when you raised him from the dead, and set him at your own right hand, far above all principality, power, dominion, might, every name that is named. Thank you, Father, that you raised us together with him, and that we are in the throne. I thank you for the fullness of that reality opening up to us, Lord. Bringing us into a large place of knowing that reality. In Christ's name. Amen. Turn to Job chapter 33. Job's before Psalms. Job 33. Job chapter 33, verse 4 says, "The Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of the Almighty has given me life." That word there for spirit is ruach. That word there for breath is neshama. Here we have both the neshama and the ruach, which is the Holy Spirit. It's twofold. That's why we have the two olive trees pouring oil into the lampstand to bring forth the light of Christ. It is these two spirits, the spirit of grace and truth, the ruach and the neshama. The Spirit of God made me, the ruach. See, there's the spirit of truth. And how did he make us? When he wrote us in the book. That is where we were made. In the volume of the book, it is written of me. Or as David, that's Psalm 40. But in Psalm 139, of course, it said, "In your book, all my members were written, while in continuance they were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them." We came forth out of the book. Out of his purpose for us as he's writing, this is who Danish is. This is who Catherine is. The spirit, the ruach that God made me, that spirit of truth that was written in that book. Our identity in Christ. The Spirit of God made me, the breath, the neshama of the Almighty has given me life. There's the spirit of grace, the power of his love, the will of the Father. And so we have the word and then his breath of grace coming upon that word, and the reality of that comes into play of our life. Our life in him. And so how do we come back into that? By coming back up to the throne room where mercy and truth meet together. There we have the spirit of truth. They shall sit upon it in truth. There is our identity in Christ, what was written of us, and covered in his mercy where his grace comes. And grace and truth is there. There is our true identity in Christ in the throne room. That was just being released as I was driving over here. Mm-hmm. Yesterday, I received this. It was consciousness is the reality that we abide in by faith. Just think about that for a second. Consciousness is the reality that we abide in by faith. So the reality that we are currently in is because of what we believe. The lies that we believe. We're not abiding in the fullness of the reality in Christ in the throne room because there's still lies that we're believing. And so it creates a consciousness, an awareness. And there's still, I don't know about some of you, but there's still awareness of self in me. How do we come into the consciousness of coming into this large place? By faith. Knowing we are there. There, that is where I am. If you then be risen with Christ, Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. Where are we risen with Christ? Yes. Seek those things which are above. Where? He's talking about where? In the throne room. Where Christ sitteth in the right hand of God. Where mercy and truth meet together. This is your identity. Where it was written of you in the book. And in that blood of Christ comes the grace. Grace and truth meeting together there. Your true identity. In Christ. Where in that hidden place, hid in Christ. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth in the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth, for you are dead. And your life, your true life, is hid in that secret place, in that hidden place. Your true life is hid with Christ in God. And when Christ, our life, shall appear, that's the full reality coming as we fully lay hold of our life in Him. When Christ, our life, shall appear, that's our true identity, then we also shall appear with Him in glory because it's who we are. It's who we were created to be. And so our consciousness, how do we walk in the light? By faith. How did Enoch walk with God? He was walking in the Spirit. He was walking in the eternal paths of mercy and truth. In the light. In the light of the Father's face. The good pleasure of the Father's will. What's the good pleasure of the Father's will? Our identity in Christ. That's the only thing acceptable, right? And so we can't look at, well, I'm not well-pleasing because I messed up. No, I reject that. No, that's right. That's not who I am. You can criticize what I just did, but that's right. That's not me. Yeah. That's Christ that's in me. Amen. And that's where we begin to come to that place, as it says in Psalm 31:19, oh, how great. As David says, how great is your goodness. It's the goodness of His house where the working of His Spirit. How great is that goodness which you have laid up. See, there's this inheritance. Which you have laid up for them that fear you. Which you have wrought for them that trust in you. See, it's by faith. That trust in you before the sons of men. Thou shalt hide them. In the secret of your face, from the pride of man. See, there's this, that's right, that's not who I am. It's Christ is who I am. Thou shalt hide them in the secret of your face from the pride of man. See, there's us humbling ourselves under the mighty hand of God, under His hand of mercy. We're already there, but the humbling is simply by faith saying, no, yes, this is who I am. It's not the old man. You know, my concern in some regards as far as some of what the hyper grace message brings, it almost preserves the old man. It's okay. Mm-hmm. You know, you're covered, right? No, that's never was the purpose. It was always, no, this isn't who you are. The old man's dead. There is no excuse for that. This is my identity. Here, Christ. Mm-hmm. Yes, he covers us in his blood to give us time to our mind to shift and change and lay hold of our identity, but it's never to give excuses to the old man that somehow it's okay. It's never okay. It's coming to the revelation that that's dead, and there's my life. And what the law couldn't do, because you cannot reform the old man. Under the law, the righteousness in essence was trying to reform the old man, which you can't do. But grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Because what's that? That's our identity in him. The Spirit of grace and truth, the Holy Spirit. In that is the new creation and the renewing of our minds to this is who I am. See, this is what Titus chapter 3 verse 4 is talking about. Where it says, but when the kindness, is the Greek word Christotes, but when the goodness and love of God, our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but by his own mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration. What's that? That's born again. By the Spirit of grace. The washing of regeneration. That was being birthed into the womb of the morning. By the washing of regeneration. There's the Spirit of grace. And the renewing of the Holy Spirit. What's that? The renewing of the mind. There is grace and truth. This is who I am. That's all it is the renewing of the mind, right? No, that's not who I am. This is who I am. By faith, David said, I will walk before the Lord. Before his face in the land of the living. I believed, therefore I spoke. Only by faith can we be brought into that place. The reality of it. Living in the reality of the Christ life. Is by holding our life in the Lord, by beholding him in us. Yes, that's my life. All that other gunk. Yeah, that's right. That's not me. Criticize it. It's not me. You're right. That's that dead guy. Why do we keep trying to preserve the dead guy? You know, David didn't say, preserve me, O God. He wasn't saying, preserve my flesh. He was saying, it's my identity in Christ. I'm preserved in mercy and truth because that's my true identity. I was written in the book. And the Spirit of grace and truth, the Spirit of God made me. The breath of the Almighty has given me life. And of course, Jesus breathed on them and said, receive ye the Holy Spirit. Come back into that identity. I felt like the Holy Spirit had me go to Psalm chapter 40 this week. That's kind of where all this began. Wow, an amazing psalm. Psalm chapter 40, verse 1 begins with, I waited patiently for the Lord. And that word waited and that word patiently are the same Hebrew word. So it's intensifying it. Just like in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3, where it says, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace is actually shalom, shalom. It's an intensified peace. Perfect peace. Here it's the same thing. It's, I waited, waited. On the Lord. And so what's he acknowledging? That by, how do we wait? By faith. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. To come into the reality. To step. See, he's talking about this psalm. He's talking about the experience of coming into the large place. Of stepping into this, coming in, the Lord bringing him into this consciousness, this awareness. As he said in Psalm 118, he brought me into a large place. That's that large upper room where we eat and drink of him, of mercy and truth, our true identity. Where we come to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, the height, the depth, the breadth, the length. Is that it's the faith in knowing that the Father is going to bring us into that. But we have to stand in faith, and that's waiting patiently. Waiting, waiting. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Mm. That's in the enlarging of it. And what was that out of? That was out of Psalm 27, which what was David talking about in Psalm 27? The Lord is my light and my salvation. He came into this, and he's talking about the secret place, the hidden place. You said, seek ye my face. My heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Mercy and truth go before his face. So here in Psalm 40, he again is talking about coming into this place. I waited patiently. I waited, waited by faith on the Lord. For the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of a miry clay, that old flesh life, the beholding of the flesh, and set my feet upon a rock, the truth in Christ. This is my life. This is my righteousness. Set my feet upon a rock, the rock Christ Jesus, and established my goings. Whoa. He hath put a new song in my mouth, praise unto our God. Many shall see and fear. Did this become an amazing reality in his life? Are you hearing what he's saying? Many shall see and hear. I mean, this was... boom, he stepped into this reality. He hath put a new song in my mouth, praise unto our God. Many shall see and fear and shall trust in the Lord. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust, faith, and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. Many, O Lord my God, are thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are to usward. They cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. Where did he talk about that? Psalm 139. Your thoughts towards me are more than the sand, if I should count them. If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand, your thoughts towards me. This is when he came into this large place, the height, the depth, the breadth, the length. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. And all this was opening up the Father's thoughts towards him. Him writing it in the book. This is who you are, David. Beloved of God. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. Sacrifice, verse 6, sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Under the law, the sacrifice and offering all pointed to Christ. And here David got that full revelation. Sacrifice and offering thou did not desire. It was all about pointing to the one. But mine ear hast thou opened. This is David saying, he opened his ear to what? Hear. To hear what? Today, if you will hear his voice. Psalm 95. What is his voice calling us to? Faith. Trust me. I will bring you in. Trust me. What does Psalm 95 say? We are the people of his pasture, the sheep of his hand. Come under my hand of mercy in faith. Today, if you will hear his voice, trust me. But what does it say about those in the wilderness? They didn't enter in because of unbelief. And what is our promised land? The throne room. How do we enter in? By faith. We're not slaves. We're sons of the King. We're one with him. Let me go back a little bit. This word weighted in the Hebrew, if you look at it, it means twisted or being entwined. Similar to that word we looked at the other week in the Greek in John chapter 15, verse 7. What was that word we were talking about? John chapter 15, verse 1. The vine means twisted and it's about being one with him. And in our faith, in our waiting, it's about coming one with him again. As we abide there in faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. Because it's in faith that we abide in the identity in Christ. Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. And see, what did that sacrifice and offering do? It brought us back to the place. Its whole purpose was to bring us back into the Father's hand. Into your hands I commit my spirit, that he would draw all men back to there, into their true identity in mercy and truth, where the Spirit of grace and truth come and bring us back in. Mine ears hast thou opened. Burnt offering and sin offering hast thou not required. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me. I believe this is twofold. It not only speaks of Christ, we know that because Paul quotes it in Hebrews, speaking of Christ. Lo, I come. And what was Christ's purpose? Lo, I come to take them back. To pay the price to take them back to that place, into your hands, Father. But it also was written by David, and he says, lo, I come to you, Father. I'm coming back into your hands. In the volume of the book, it is written of me, the Spirit of truth, what you wrote in the book. This is who David is. He delights to do my will. He's a man after my own heart. Lo, I come. We can all say, lo, I come in faith, back. In the volume of the book, it is written of me. I delight to do your will, O God. What's the promise of the new covenant? That the law would be written upon our hearts. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart through the Spirit of grace and truth. The law of liberty, of coming back into our identity, not by works of reforming the old man, but by laying hold of our identity in him. As it says in Romans chapter 8, there is therefore no condemnation. Because it's like, no, this is who I am. There's no condemnation. You can't condemn me, right? Because you're right. That's not me. And if you're condemning Christ, then yeah, that's who I am. There is therefore no condemnation. But there is condemnation under the law. Why? Because you're trying to reform the old man. And the old man is not acceptable. You can't reform the old man. There is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, abiding in the hidden place in mercy and truth, who walk not after the flesh, trying to reform the flesh, trying to do good enough, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. In mercy and truth, walking in the eternal paths of mercy and truth, in the light, as Enoch walked in the light, where our true identity is. Walking before the Father's face, well-pleasing. There is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life, this is this, the breath of God. It's the Ruach and the Neshama. The law of the Spirit of life. He breathed on them. See, grace, the law was given by Moses, but the law of Christ, grace and truth, came through Jesus Christ. To bring us back to what was written of us. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made us free from the law of sin and death, trying to reform the old man. For what the law could not do, it couldn't reform the old man. Mm-hmm. It never was to reform the old man. It was to show you, you can't reform the old man. You can't. You got to be born again. Into the womb of the morning. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us that walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. This is who I am. This is who I am. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is in my heart. The spirit of truth was poured into my heart. The love of God was poured into my heart. The lawgiver on the day of Pentecost. It's the lawgiver poured into my heart to bring me back into that. My identity in Christ, renewing my mind back to that. That I may lay hold of my inheritance in Christ. That we would overcome, that we would sit with him on the throne. We overcome by faith. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. What was that testimony? Truth! This is who I am! Psalm 40, verse 7. Then said I, lo, I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. I have preached righteousness in the great congregation. Lo, I have not refrained my lips. O Lord, thou knowest. I have not hid thy righteousness within my heart. I have declared thy faithfulness and thy salvation. Next part of verse 10. I have not concealed thy loving kindness, is the Hebrew word kesed. I have not concealed thy mercy and thy truth from the great congregation. Withhold not thou thy mercies from me, O Lord. Let thy loving kindness, thy mercy and thy truth continually preserve me. There is my identity. He says it twice here. Mercy and truth. Mercy and truth. See, this is him having been brought into that place. This is what struck me this week, the Holy Spirit, I believe. When David said, I have not concealed thy mercy and thy truth from the great congregation. Think about that. David was not only talking about the people of those days, but he was speaking to us, the great congregation. He was revealing that to us, even through the Psalms, through his writings, revealing the great mystery of Christ to bring us back into the womb of the morning, back into the secret place, back into the throne room. This is the tabernacle of David. This throne room of mercy and truth, entering back into our identity in Christ. See, it says in Ezekiel, we were just talking about Ezekiel. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 34. Ezekiel 34, verse 1 begins, kind of a somber. And the word of the Lord came unto me, Ezekiel, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say unto them, Thus saith the Lord God unto the shepherds, Woe to the shepherds of Israel that do feed themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flocks? Ye eat the fat, ye clothe you with the wool, ye kill them that are fed, but ye feed not the flock. So that's the context here of Ezekiel 34. Now go to verse 23. The Lord is my shepherd. Verse 23. And I, this is the Father, Heavenly Father speaking, I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, even my servant David. He shall feed them, and he shall be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken it. And I will make them a covenant of peace. Think about what this means. Jesus never said he was David. He called himself the son of David. This is talking about David, but his revelation speaking to future generations. This is, I have not concealed your mercy and truth unto the great congregation. David saw it. David saw this revelation that he was graced for the Father to bring him into, that it was going to be revealed to the great congregation for generations and thousands of years to bring the people into the fullness of Christ. The mystery of Christ that Paul talks about comes primarily from David. The height, the depth, the breadth, the length, that comes from Psalm 139. Mercy and truth, it comes from Psalm 139. Paul talks about mercy and truth in Romans. But it all began with David. This is the raising up of the tabernacle of David that has fallen. To bring the church to maturity at the end of the age. Back there to Ezekiel, and I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them. Of course, David was a shepherd, wasn't he? My servant David, he shall feed them, and he shall be their shepherd. To bring them into the secret place, into their true identity in Christ. Not declaring himself, but declaring Christ. Through the blood, through the body, through mercy and truth, this is who you are. Bringing us all, the great congregation, into the large place. Why did the tabernacle of David fall? I don't believe it was the enemy. It was just David was given to us, it says in Isaiah 55, for a witness, a leader and a commander to the people. And you shall call a nation which thou knowest not, and nations which know not thee shall run unto thee because of the Lord thy God and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. Word that came out, it came out of David. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David, the faithful mercies of David. The covenant, what covenant? This covenant of peace that is talking about right here in Ezekiel 34. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken it, and I will make with them a covenant of peace. If you look at Isaiah 55, or actually 54 leading up to that, it talks about the everlasting covenant of peace. Well, where is that peace? In Christ, right? It's coming into our full identity, that perfect peace. That will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, whose imagination is stayed on thee by faith. Trust ye in the Lord, it says the next verse there in Isaiah 26. Trust ye in the Lord. For the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. We put our trust in you, Lord. We thank you for quickening our hearts and our minds. By your Ruach, by your Neshama. By your breath, you draw us out of many waters and set us in a large place. That we would be brought into that reality. That we walk, O Lord, with you in the light of your face, well-pleasing. response in this place that you cause spiritual acceleration. And mercy, the throne is established, and he shall sit upon it in truth in the tabernacle of David, judging and seeking judgment and hasting righteousness, the government of God. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with righteousness and judgment from this day forth and forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts shall perform this. It says the government shall be upon his shoulder. Mercy and truth. The key of David is upon his shoulder. What's the key to his government? Our identity in Christ. We wait for you, Father. We wait patiently for you. We trust you to bring us into the fullness. That Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. That we, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height. To know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. That we might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto you who are able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto you be glory in the church throughout all ages, world without end. Amen.